Ms. Holland has traveled from New York to join us. She's a research scholar and director of the Graduate Lawyering Program at NYU School of Law. She has written on vaccine law and policy and is the co-author and co-editor of the book Vaccine Epidemic. She has testified on vaccine matters at the United Nations and in New York, California, Maine, West Virginia, and Vermont legislatures. She is the chair of the Advisory Board of Health Choice and a member of the advisory boards for the Elizabeth Birth Center and Autism Law School, Law and Advocacy, sorry. Whew, that's a long name. That's enough?
Close enough.
Close enough, oh, okay. She's also on the advisory board of IPAC, the World Mercury Project, the Auto Spect School, and Action Play, an equal access arts program for children with autism and special needs. So I'm looking forward to this talk. Please welcome Mary Holland.
Thank you all so much. It's really an honor and a privilege to be here. I have the opportunity to speak right after lunch, which is always a challenge for everybody. So if you feel the need to stand up and walk around, as I'm going to do, stretch your legs, you know, wake yourself up a little bit, I will not be in the least offended. On the contrary, I'll be delighted. So we're going to talk about informed consent. I'm going to talk about the role of law. So I'm coming at this as a lawyer. I'm also coming at this as a parent of a vaccine-injured child. That's really what got me started. And I thought, well, what can I contribute to this movement and what we need to do? And I thought, well, I don't want to go out of my area of expertise. Let me work in my, you know, wheelhouse. Let me work on legal issues. And I have to say, and let me be a scholar. That's what I do. I teach. Let me see what I can contribute to this discourse around that. And it's absolutely fascinating, right? So law has everything to do with what's happened. And so I'm going to try, we've had fantastic presentations on the environment and on genetics and on the medicine and on the science. I'm going to try to fill in the legal gaps because I think law is essential. And that's what many of you I know are running up against every day, right? What does Washington law say? What does federal law say? What's it going to say 5 years from now? Even more scary. And so as Garth said, I'm also the co-editor and co-author of Vaccine Epidemic, which is for sale outside. And I want to say I'm really thrilled that another co-author is here, Michael Belkin, a really noted Washington advocate for vaccination choice and in the band The Refusers. Oops. And somebody who's really been at this work for a lot longer than I have. And I'm deeply grateful to his support and his work. Okay, so, and there are many people here in the audience I know who are fantastically knowledgeable, and I look forward to talking with you. I will not speak the whole time because I want us to have time to actually have sort of a dialogue about some of these questions. So law, autism, you know, injury, brain damage, asthma, diabetes, huh? Like, what's going on here? You know, Jack talked to us about genes and environment, but law, is that really part of the problem? And yes, law is a huge piece of this problem, right? So we're seeing what plausibly, I'm focusing on autism, but it could be beyond autism, certainly. There are a lot of legal things that flow from autism. Let's just call it for autism for now. Special education, insurance, family law, criminal law, vaccine law. All those things are impacted. And I just want to say in general, we live in an incredibly litigious society, right? We are known the world over as being people who will go to court over pretty incredible things that other societies don't go to court over. You know, if you trash my professional reputation, I may take you to court. If you and I sign a contract and we agree we're going to do certain things and you don't do them, I'm going to take you to court. If, you know, you and I were married and we get divorced and you don't pay enough for my kids' child support, I can take you to court. And yet when it comes to vaccines and when it comes to autism, among others, we really don't have really good legal recourse, and I'm going to explain that. We really, really have impaired legal access in this area. And even though we are told that there is a fundamental human right to prior, free, and informed consent, in real life, as you all know only too well, it's really hard to access that right in the world in which we live today. So, we're going to talk about, you know, is law a cause of the autism epidemic and the other epidemics of chronic childhood diseases that we see? Are vaccinations playing a role? Could law be a driver for these epidemics of chronic childhood disabilities and illnesses and disorders? So I'm going to focus on autism, but I say it goes broader than this. So here's a photo of the DSM-4. We're now into DSM-5. Autism is something that affects social interaction, communication, stereotypical behaviors, and the onset's before age 3. And we know that autism has, as both Jack and others are going to point out, it's just risen precipitously over the last 3 decades. And in fact, it has risen, you know, pretty much on the same basic curve as the number of childhood vaccines. So could there be a link? That's a question. I think it was actually first Michael Belkin who pointed out to me that it was absolutely mainstream medicine and accepted. If you look at this, this is from the Merck manual, which every pediatrician has in their office, and most doctors, I presume. And if you look at the third bullet point here, it says a virus, at the bottom bullet, a virus or vaccine triggers a reaction that makes the immune system attack brain tissue. Autoimmune reaction. This is the Merck manual. This is not, you know, fringe anti-vax propaganda, right? This is the Merck manual that acknowledged decades ago that a vaccine works like the infectious disease, right? It's triggering the immune system, and it can trigger a reaction in the brain. So this is not so mysterious, really. So one question is, one of the dimensions of vaccine law, and we'll be talking about it, is that we have this 1986 National Childhood Vaccine Injury Act, and it created a compensation program. And your limited legal recourse rights when it comes to vaccine injury include that you have to file a lawsuit in the vaccine injury compensation program first. Well, the vaccine injury compensation program recognizes that encephalopathy, so brain damage, or seizures and their consequences, are vaccine injuries. And the characteristics of those vaccine injuries that the program acknowledges include, lo and behold, impaired social relations, non-responsiveness to stimuli, lack of normal eye gaze. What does that sound like? Sounds like a lot like autism, right? So we also know that based on studies by scientists at the Environmental Protection Agency, that 88-89, just when the U.S. federal vaccine schedule recommendations were ramping up, we saw very dramatic changes in autism incidence. And we saw it not only in the U.S., but in other countries, Japan and Denmark, that to some extent follow similar vaccine schedules as the United States. There is sort of global coordination on some levels at the World Health Organization level when it comes to childhood vaccinations. So we saw here in this time period a number of different vaccines, and their ingredients were being changed, right? So Hib, mumps, DTaP, Hep B, varicella, flu vaccine. All of those were being added roughly at the same time. This is a slightly older version of the schedule, but it virtually is the same. You know, we have a pretty ramped up schedule. It's even more now, but, you know, DTaP, MMR, flu, polio, Prevnar, rotavirus, varicella, Menactra, and human papillomavirus. And every year a kid is supposed to get a flu vaccine just like all the rest of us, right? Basically, the federal recommendations are cradle to grave, literally pre-cradle to maybe even post-grave. Who knows? Maybe that's the next step, right? But it's definitely pre-cradle through grave. That'll be the next step, right? The post-grave. So how did we get here? I think that's a legal question. It really is a legal question. How could we get to where we have this schedule and we have so few legal options for redress? And I think of courts, maybe naively, but, you know, I believe in the system. We go to courts to find justice, but we also go to courts to find truth. And we have very little access to those institutions. So how did we get here? So I like to look at this as sort of the role of law is in two parts. We live in a federal country, so we have state laws that permit states to compel vaccination under state police powers. They're called police powers. That should make us sort of like stop and think for a minute. It's police powers that are allowing the states to impose compulsory vaccination. And then we have a federal law, the 1986 Act, which relieves manufacturers and doctors of almost all liability in the event of a vaccine injury. So we have a double whammy, right? We have on the front end, the states can compel, and on the back end, the doctors and the manufacturers aren't responsible. I mean, that's incredible. That's really an incredible reality, but that's the reality we have to look at. And so let's, how did we get here? How did this happen? So the first step is looking at where did this idea that a state can compel a mandate, a vaccine mandate, where did that come from? So it's, I find it very instructive to go back in history and see that it came from a Supreme Court decision in 1905, Jacobson versus Massachusetts. So this is the landmark fundamental case for all those pro-vaxxers out there, okay? And it's really important to remember that Jacobson happened after there'd already been a lot of litigation around smallpox mandates. A lot of different states and localities, you know, cities, had been imposing smallpox mandates. Smallpox is a nasty disease, right? Airborne, highly contagious, deadly. No question it was deadly, scary, really, really scary. And, it, you know, it had been around since forever. It had been a scourge of Europe and of Asia. And, you know, since the 1700s, many people had found that vaccination was effective. We can go back and debate whether that was true and what the history shows, but a lot of people, including a lot of physicians, thought that vaccination was effective. A lot of physicians thought it wasn't effective. But in 1905, Reverend Jacobson basically objects to vaccination for himself. So Cambridge passes this mandate that says you have to take the vaccine, and if you don't, you have to pay a $5 fine. And it was only imposed, this mandate was only imposed on the adult population. They said that, you know, there may be really good reasons why we wouldn't impose the same regulation on people of quote-unquote tender years. I find that pretty interesting. So the Supreme Court says, you know what? Who are we to second guess the Cambridge authorities or the state of Massachusetts that's already looked at this mandate? You know, this is a deadly disease. You guys in government, it's your job to protect your populations. We assume that you wouldn't have put this in place without in the legislature hearing from experts on both sides. And we're gonna, you know, give you deference that there must have been, and there must be for you to implement something this universal and this, you know, invasive, there must be necessity. There must be, this must be reasonable, right? This must be proportionate to the threat. You must have some kind of harm avoidance. If you can come forward and say, I think I'm at risk of being harmed by this vaccine. I have a family history. I have genetic susceptibility. You could say this in 1905. Then I shouldn't be required to take a vaccine. And fifth, we can't say that, oh, you know, just the Jews are going to get these vaccines or just the Chinese, as they tried to do in California. There has to be non-discrimination. If you're going to have a universal mandate, it has to be a universal mandate. So, you know, in the context of 1905, when the science was infinitely less advanced than what Jennifer and Jack have just showed us, this was, from my perspective, this was not an unreasonable finding. Do I agree with it? Who would I have sided with? I'm sure I would have sided with Reverend Jacobson, that he had a right to due process and equal protection to protect his own body and his own philosophy of health, right? There were even discussions back when the Constitution was being drafted. Gee, maybe there should be in the Bill of Rights, you know, a protection around people's own philosophies around health. But sad to say, that didn't make it into the Constitution or into the Bill of Rights, so here we are. So, the mandate was one vaccine, it was for smallpox, it was in the context of an epidemic, there were medical exemptions that were gonna be honored, and the fine for non-compliance was, you know, not so big. $5, today it's like $120, right? It's a little bit more than when I made the slide. Today, you know, where are we? These are mandates that are being imposed primarily on children, not on adults. We're imposing them outside of the context of epidemics. We're imposing them for sexually transmissible diseases, supposedly for cancer that may happen 30 years from now. We're doing it on a one-size-fits-all basis. We're imposing them for people to go to school. We're imposing them for people to be able to work in a number of different institutions. And sometimes we have religious and philosophical exemptions, and we know all too well that those are under attack. But the basis for these mandates comes from the 1905 Supreme Court landmark decision, Jacobson versus Massachusetts, that sometimes the freedom of the individual has to be subordinated to the common welfare. Okay, so, but the law is never static, right? The law is never static. It's always dynamic. That's one of the beauties of the kind of law we have, common law. We don't wait for just the legislature to say, you know, this is what the law is. You know, there's cases every day, and the cases form the new level of law. And so on the right-hand side, we see that law has evolved incredibly since 1905 in this area of bodily integrity and autonomy and prior free and informed consent, right? So we no longer, we now think that forced sterilization, which was justified based on Jacobson in the 1920s by the Supreme Court, was justified by on Jacobson, that's now considered an international human rights violation, right? So forced sterilization is a complete abrogation of law. That is a crime in the United States. Access to contraception was once, and abortion were found to be illegal. They are now constitutional. The right to refuse unwanted medical treatment is now considered a fundamental human right. The right to, you know, have sex with whoever you want is now considered to be a fundamental bodily integrity autonomy norm. And yet, this vaccine law has remained virtually static. And it's actually been, if you will, kind of reified. It's been reinforced and reinforced by precedents since then that specifically are looked at in the context of vaccines, not looked at much in the broader context of bodily integrity, prior free and informed consent, and autonomy. So one of the steps between Jacobson and 1986, which is important, is that in the 1920s, there was a case that specifically related to a smallpox mandate just for a school. And it was in the context where there was no outbreak at that time of smallpox. And so this case came to the Supreme Court, and it's really apples and oranges. This is not a case like Jacobson, but it's used as if it was like Jacobson. So this was actually a procedural decision. It was four paragraphs long, and they said, yeah, you can apply the mandates to school children. You don't have to have an outbreak. But it's not a really thoughtful decision. It didn't pretend to be. It's a procedural decision. But the way in which Zucht versus King is used is that there can be mandates outside of outbreaks just for children. So that's a really important link here. So, but as we know, we still do have religious exemptions in the vast majority of states, and some states offer philosophical exemptions. But we have these sort of conflicting narratives around vaccine law, right? So manufacturers, they say that if we didn't have these protections, we would have crippling litigation, there'd be huge damage awards against us. You know, the manufacturers were threatening to leave the marketplace in the 1980s, which is when this federal statute came in. And that, you know, people are looking for somebody to blame, and they're going to blame the manufacturers and the doctors. Whereas parents, and this is back in the 80s when this law was being put in place, they said, no, you know, these are just not very well-designed vaccines. You know, you can do better. You can do better. The regulatory system isn't working. The risks are excessive. And the tort system isn't really allowing most families to get compensated. So up until the 80s, some families were being compensated. And they were making all the arguments that people are making today. So for better or worse, manufacturers, doctors, and parents of vaccine-injured children negotiated for years, and they came up with this 1986 National Childhood Vaccine Injury Act. And it's my strong belief that that at least the parent population of vaccine-injured children, they did this with the best of intentions, hoping that truly, like, this would be an improvement. But I think now we can look back and say, that didn't happen. So the objectives of this statute, this federal law, were to stabilize the supply, to compensate the injured, and to make vaccines safer. But there's this acknowledgement that vaccines are, quote unquote, unavoidably unsafe. Okay, like all prescription medications. All prescription medications, why are they prescribed? Because if you just do them on a one-size-fits-all basis or over the counter, they may cause injuries. So that's really the fundamental basis for why there's liability protection for industry. The way in which this compensation fund is created is not through money that's taken out of the pockets of pharma. It's taken out of 75% tax, an excise tax on every vaccine that the manufacturers merely collect. We pay for vaccine injury compensation, we who buy vaccines. And it severely limited recourse to civil courts. So basically what this statute said was that you have to file first in this compensation program. And you have to, more importantly, you have to know that it exists, and you have to file within 3 years. Think about this. If you go to a religious institution and your priest or your whoever, your minister, molests your kid, that kid may have until age 21 or 30 to sue that church official. You don't know, and your doctor doesn't know what vaccine injury looks like. They don't recognize that autism is often encephalopathy. They don't recognize that. And so you're not really able to sue, and then the statute of limitations is run, and then there's no recourse, lo and behold. So anyway, the compromise was no liability for industry. Families have to file in 3 years. There's cap damages. Special masters are the fact finding. There's no juries. There's very limited discovery. On the upside for families who are injured, they don't pay their own legal fees. So the government pays legal fees. There's downsides to that. It was supposed to be swift, generous, and certain. That didn't really happen. And in theory, you have concurrent jurisdiction. So once you filed in this vaccine injury compensation program, you can wait 240 days or you can get a negative judgment, and then you can go and you can sue in a civil court. So it hasn't worked out this way, but here's just the law from this. This was based on this restatement of the law. Vaccines, it's acknowledged in this restatement of torts, are products which in the present state of human knowledge are incapable of being made safe for their intended and ordinary use. And this is really the basis for that 1986 statute. And one terrific judge who, before the 1986 statute, he said, the reason that people had, and they talk about it in terms of the rabies vaccine, he's like, the reason that we allow these products is because somebody has been infected with rabies. They're willing to take the risk because they know they're going to die otherwise. And he points out in this case decision from the Supreme Court of Nevada, that's not the case with routine childhood vaccines. These people should, you know, the manufacturers should not be getting a free pass for unavoidably unsafe products. So, you know, the under this act, there's supposed to be safety research. They're supposed to update the table injuries so that you can be compensated more generously. They're supposed to resolve claims quickly. It's supposed to be non-adversarial, but it hasn't worked out that way. There's, as we know, very little safety research. There's almost no injuries have been added to the table. Ridiculously so. It's exceptionally adversarial. 90% of claims are now off the table. Most claimants lose. I think as the first speaker pointed out, you know, it makes vaccines look bad. If you grant compensation to people, you're just acknowledging that these are risky products. And we know that there is a very concerted social, governmental, medical effort to downplay the risk of these products. So all of that said, there still has been $3.6 billion of outlays, both for the compensation awards and for the attorneys, to over 5,200 families since the 86 Act. And that's very few people know about this program, right? And people have been compensated for all of these things which we see as, you know, problems among children. SIDS, right? People have been compensated. Anaphylaxis, encephalopathy, which may have features of autism, paralytic polio, all of these things are things that have been, in fact, compensated. So another feature of this 1986 Act is the VAERS reporting system. So this is the Vaccine Adverse Event Reporting System. It's under the FDA. Doctors and families can report vaccine injuries. Again, you have to know it's a vaccine injury. Most people don't know. Most people don't know that VAERS exists. It's a passive reporting system. If a doctor doesn't report a vaccine injury, there's no penalty. Typically, with the FDA, a former FDA commissioner said about 1 to 10% of adverse events are recorded. So you have to ask if there are, you know, 588,000 that have been reported, you know, what does that mean? If it's 1 in 10, it's 5.9 or 59 million potential vaccine adverse reactions. It's a lot, right? I mean, this is a problem. So on autism, there was a proceeding. I personally had high hopes that this might be a genuine court proceeding under this Court of Federal Claims. They tested two hypotheses, mercury-induced autism, was that related to vaccines or measles, mumps, rubella? Six cases were heard, and all the cases were ruled against. Some of them were appealed to the appellate level, and it was a finding that there was no connection between vaccines and autism. That despite the fact that there had been been public disclosure and statements by the head of the Centers for Disease Control, Julie Gerberding, who acknowledged that Hannah Poling, whose father happened to be a neurologist at Johns Hopkins and who did extensive testing, the head of the CDC had already acknowledged that her her autism was caused by her vaccines. And they said that compensation is appropriate and that she had encephalopathy with features of autism spectrum disorder. So they settled her case. They didn't do it in the ordinary course. And the reason for doing that in part was to make sure that there would be no precedential effect and it would not affect the other 5,000 cases that were filed there. And this one to me is just mind-boggling. In one of these decisions from the Omnis Autism Proceeding, this special master wrote, "An objective observer would have to emulate Lewis Carroll's White Queen and be able to believe six impossible, or at least highly improbable things before breakfast to decide in petitioner's favor." So to me, this was just unbelievably disrespectful. Respectful, not to mention sort of illogical.
Scientifically incorrect.
Unquestionably. Morally incorrect, I would say, moreover. So shortly after this, in 2011, the Supreme Court handed down arguably the next most important decision related to vaccines, Brucewitz versus Wyeth. And one mom of a daughter who died after the HPV vaccine was in a demonstration with me and others in front of the Supreme Court after the decision, where she said, you know, this decision means that it's all profits, no liability. And what that means is when there is a defectively designed vaccine. And many people, this was a case actually about the DPT, which then became the DPAT, or it could have been about thimerosal in vaccines, or it could be today, but for this law, about aluminum in vaccines or other adjuvants. You can't file those lawsuits in any court in the United States. So we sort of came up with a slogan, you're on your own. You're really on your own. Think about that. If you decide that your kid's HPV vaccine was simply defectively designed, you cannot sue on that theory in any court ever. That is something that, according to the Supreme Court, has to be decided by the FDA or by the CDC. So I was involved with others in doing a study from cases in the Vaccine Injury Compensation Program. Just a group of us contacted 150 families where they had been compensated for encephalopathy or for seizure disorder. And non-lawyers, so that there was no conflict about, you know, lawyers contacting people, you know, does your kid have autism? And we found 83 people who said, yeah, of course my kid has autism, there's no question. And then we thought, oh my God, this should be impossible, right? There should be no autism. If there's no connection between vaccines and autism, there should be no people in this program. We were only able to contact 150. This should be like a pink unicorn. This should totally not exist. And we thought, nobody will ever believe us. Let's have them do a structured survey and let's have them, you know, note symptoms of their child. And the parental reports were perfect. I mean, if the parent said the kid is severely autistic, well, that's what the survey came back as showing. So we found 83 cases of autism among these. We then had a wonderful documentary filmmaker, Greg Dobbs, do a fabulous video that you can see on this EBCALA website. You know, has this still been proven? No. I mean, we still don't have the science. People are afraid to do the science for very good reason, right? The fear that they will be wakefielded is a real fear. What could we have proof? Of course we could have proof. This is not very hard to prove. We could just have a large-scale prospective vax-on-vax study. That would be pretty easy to do. We could have small ones. We could review the cases from the Vaccine Injury Compensation Program. We could do a genetic test on all the people who've been compensated. Wouldn't that be useful, right? We could figure out what are the genetic susceptibilities so we don't give people those. We could be doing this on primates, but those studies have been thwarted. But I do think, you know, if law got us into this mess, law potentially can get us out of it. It has to. There's really no other way. We have to change laws on this. So we do know that vaccination choice is a human right. And I'm going to show you the last slide. I mean, we have global standards. We have standards in this country at the state level for all other medical procedures. We need to use, I know many of you are talking to your legislators all the time. I think that's fantastic. That's what you need to be doing. But we do seem to have a federal executive in the White House, surprisingly, who believes that that vaccines are a part of the problem with autism. There's no question. He's made many public statements to that effect. This is somebody who's sympathetic to the idea that vaccines are causing unintended harm. Think whatever you will of our current president. He has been more outspoken on this issue than arguably any other federal politician. And he's now designated, he's at least expressed the interest in having Robert Kennedy serve as the head of a committee on vaccine safety, which I think is fantastic. So, yes, round of applause. So I do think, going back to Jacobson, I think today far more than in 1905, the vaccine mandates that we have violate the 14th Amendment protections of due process and equal protection. I think that's pretty demonstrable. I make that case at some length in Vaccine Epidemic. You can find stuff on the web that I've also done. We can certainly talk more about this in Q&A. This book is a good book in that it has many of the perspectives you're hearing today. It's not just sort of a legal perspective. It's got science, it's got law, it's got medicine, it's got Michael's sort of business perspective, which is very illuminating to me. He describes this as a vaccine bubble, and guess what? All financial bubbles eventually burst. This one's going to burst. We don't know when, but it's going to burst, and it's not going to be pretty. And so we're, for sure, ahead of the curve on this. I don't know about you all. I feel like I'm a Cassandra every day, the Greek myth, where, you know, I see the future, and I tell people, and they look at me like, oh, my God, you're crazy, right? So we're all kind of familiar with that. But we are on the side of international human rights norms. There's no question about that. So in 2005, our government and 193 governments around the world signed on to the Universal Declaration on Bioethics and Human Rights, that the sole interest of science or society, i.e. herd immunity, does not trump individual rights. And guess what? These people specifically discussed vaccine mandates, and they didn't put in a carve-out for them. And it says individuals have to have prior, free, and informed consent to any preventive, diagnostic, and therapeutic medical intervention. What is a vaccine? A preventive medical intervention, right? It was adopted by all the countries, including the US, and lots of developed countries, Japan, UK, Norway, Sweden, Spain, they have a human right to say no. A kid can go to school without having been vaccinated. Doesn't mean they don't have uptake. Most of them don't have as intense vaccine childhood schedules as we have, but they have better health outcomes than we have. They have lower rates of infant mortality than we do. I could show a slide on that if you want. There's no reason, there is no public health reason, there is no empirical reason to imagine that if we stand by the right to prior, free, and informed consent for vaccination, like all other medical interventions, that we will have some public health catastrophe. There's no data to support that at all. So I want to stop with my basic remarks here and open it for questions, including for exemptions. And I'm delighted that Alan Phillips is here so we can sort of cover lots of questions.
Our late attorney, Sandra Duffy, who wrote legislation in the state of Washington to restrict mercury in expectant mothers and children three and under. This bill passed, and it was signed by the former Governor Gregoire. And then when we had the H1N1 hoax, they pulled it. The health department pulled it and right. set it aside.
Right.
And they did try to repeal it, but I guess it didn't happen. So my question is, and of course a lot of pregnant women had spontaneous abortion because of it, but aside from that, how do we get them to recognize this bill? There's no epidemic now. How do we get them to say, okay, we're going to acknowledge this law?
Well, wait, you have a law, right? And I think there's probably a carve out like New York, and I'm dealing with this in New York, that says, oh, but if the Department of Health declares an emergency, then we can put in thimerosal. If that's right. what the law says, that's what we have in New York.
Well, they said the reason they did it is because they didn't have enough mercury-free vaccines.
Right, so that's their line.
They set right. it aside, and that's just really a crazy
right.
reason.
Right, it's crazy.
So and nonsensical.
Unfortunately, I think that's probably what probably, at least I can speak from New York. I don't know Washington. In New York, you know, our forebears got passed a law that got thimerosal out of all childhood vaccines in New York. But They were not able to prevent a provision that said, but if there's an emergency and there's not available vaccines without thimerosal, the Department of Health can declare an emergency permitting the use of thimerosal. So they do it routinely, right? There's no emergency when there's not an emergency.
Right.
They do it in, so now in New York State, we are at the beginning of a lawsuit to challenge whether there's an emergency and to try to show there's no emergency.
In the state of Washington who is licensed to represent this?
I don't know.
In the absence of our late attorney who passed away.
I don't know. I mean, I think it's a great case. So that's being pursued in New York.
Okay.
I can put you in touch with the lawyer. Yes.
To replace this lawyer because she was very well respected.
I think there's definitely room for litigation around that.
Okay.
Thank you.
Do you want
to comment? Hi. My question has to do with other countries. What are countries in Europe doing? Years ago, I heard that, Scotland is eliminating certain vaccinations.
Right.
And are there any countries we can point to and say, hey, they're doing better?
There's a lot. And I'm going to get up on a website very, very soon information about like 15 other countries. Let's see. If I can get back, I have a chart here of countries.
And while you're looking at the map, I'm curious about Dr. William Thompson, who was one of the stars of the Vaxxed movie.
Right.
What is going on with him? Does he have enough signatures or whatever he needs to come before the Senate?
So on Thompson, it's not really a question of numbers of signatures. So he has said he's given a videotaped deposition to Representative Posey from Florida. And that's in the event that he should meet an untimely end, that would be released. But he has said that he is ready to testify under oath at any time. And he's now been asked to testify in at least one lawsuit in Tennessee in a civil case where I think it would be better because there would be real cross-examination. A congressional inquiry often doesn't really get to... No, I just want to get to on my...
There's
a second PowerPoint if we can get to it, and it has a chart of countries.
Now you're challenging.
So, I'm sorry.
Hold on.
So anyway, on Thompson, he's ready. It's really been a question that nobody in Congress has the courage, I'll say, to hold a hearing where he can testify. And it's extraordinary. So I was among those who was working in a prior, you know, era when the chairman was Daryl Issa, and he promised us up, down, and sideways, I'm going to hold the hearing. And we met countless times with the staffers. And we held a very successful briefing about a week before the scheduled hearing. And it was so successful that all of Pharma mobilized, and they wrote to all of the representatives, and they said, you do not have that hearing. And the hearing was nixed. It didn't happen. And that was several years ago. You can watch the briefing online. And Rolf Hazelhurst, among others, spoke. I spoke. Now the current chair of the Government Oversight and Reform Committee is Jason Chaffetz. There are people from Utah, in particular, working hard to get him to hold this hearing. Yeah, it's been years. I mean, Thompson is several years ago. So it's very demoralizing. Our people in Congress know the power of pharma. There are more pharma lobbyists than there are members of Congress. They will take them down. They have the money. They will just say, okay, you're out. We're just going to get our guy.
Did he know about all this?
Oh, sure. Yeah. No, and he's working hard on this.
No, I just wanted to add three words, and that's drain the swamp. I mean, I think the issue we're looking at here is a system of control that's in place. And this is an incredibly, the opportunity we have right now is incredible because we've never had this before, but the entrenched system did not leave just because Trump came into office or brought in some of his people. So we're moving in the right direction, and we have to see if we're going to, you know, be able to see it through or not.
And I do want to come back to your question. So this is a graph that my colleague Kim Mack Rosenberg put together. And I'm happy this will be up on the Health Choice website within a month. And this is comparing US mandates to other developed countries. And I'm just going to come over so I can read it more carefully. So you can see here that really the US is at the top of the heap for mandated vaccines. And of course, every state is slightly different. This was done last year. But basically, we more or less mandate in 16, each state recommends 16 vaccines, which is like up to 70 doses. The UK is next. And UK, you know, you have a right to refuse, but people listen to their doctors, right? And they have a national health service. People have a close relationship with their doctors. So we see similar rates of all of these chronic diseases in the UK. But look up to, you know, Countries where the vaccines are only recommended, Japan, the Netherlands, New Zealand, Norway, Spain, Sweden, these are recommended. Austria, Canada has some mandatory, but there's a constitutional right to opt out in Canada. Denmark, Finland. You know, these countries have not fallen off the map from their infectious disease load. I mean, it's preposterous, right? Because they do all the things that Jennifer just talked about. You know, they eat real food, you know? They try to limit toxins much more aggressively than we do in the United States. They don't have the same aggressive vaccine schedule for now. But the whole vaccine sort of infrastructure is global. It really is. So we have, you know, the World Health Organization, we have the Global Alliance for Vaccination and Immunization that's supported by governments, we have the Gates Foundation. So there's efforts on a global basis to have this, you know, pre-cradle through potentially post-grave. But it's useful to compare this. Empirically, we have a higher burden of infant mortality, of chronic childhood disease, and we have a higher number of kids, you know, we have more vaccines, and we have fewer opt-outs. And all of the efforts by the pharmaceutical industry and by the medical profession and by the media are to have fewer and fewer opt-outs. I don't have to tell you that.
Okay, Mary, we have a question over here.
I believe I heard you say that in New York, they have removed the mercury in the vaccines.
So in New York, I think like in Washington, there's a state statute that says thimerosal can only be used in childhood vaccines in the event of a publicly declared health emergency. And the Department of Health has to declare that. Department of Health declares it every year.
So how do you find out? This is from a very personal place. I have 4 grandchildren. How do you find out which vaccines are free of mercury, which are not? Yeah. Merck makes, and can you get single dose? I mean, how do you navigate this?
That's the easy part. Changing the laws is hard. That's the easy part. So you do, you know, you go to the pharmacy and you say to the pharmacy if they're going to give it, or you say to the pediatrician, I want to see the product insert. And the product, so doctors don't have to give you the product insert. That's one of the other terrible features of this 86 law. The 86 law just says they have to give you basically a propaganda sheet, a 2-pager that says vaccines are great. You know, the risks are minimal. You read that product insert, and it's going to tell you a lot of information, and they will talk to you about the clinical trials and the observed adverse events and the contraindications, and it'll tell you the ingredients, and it will tell you if there's thimerosal.
So when you're there for a well child visit, you can say that a doctor or nurse, I need to see the product insert.
Sure, you bet. They're your employees. Jennifer said, you don't let that doctor, and you never, I know you all know this, but you never leave a baby unattended in a hospital. You never leave your child unattended in a doctor's office. They're just too, it's too ingrained in them, and I have to assume that they believe they're doing best by the children and the infants, but truly, it's ingrained in them, and it is their quote-unquote standard of care. This is a law, right? They have to observe the standard of care, and if they don't, you could sue them for malpractice. You can't sue them for malpractice for giving your baby aluminum, but you can sue them for malpractice for not telling you that you should give your baby the vaccine with aluminum. That's the state of the law.
So if your doctor says,
So if your doctor refuses to give you the actual vaccine insert, you can go to a pharmacy and hopefully they will give it to you.
You can look on the internet.
Okay.
So if you put in Boostrix or if you put in DPT Merck, it's all on the internet. The internet's very powerful in this.
Okay.
I just had a real quick comment. Yeah. Mercury-free is not an absolute thing. You can be called mercury-free if it's below a certain level. So mercury-free vaccines may still have traces of mercury in them.
Amount. 0.5 micrograms. So that's right. 0.5 micrograms could still be there, and they would say that it's, you know, thimerosal free, meaning it's not being used as a preservative, so it's not 25 micrograms. But if you have a kid who's sensitive, you know. Right. Exactly.
I had a couple questions about the 2005 Universal Declaration. My understanding is the Nuremberg originally only applied to research studies, and this expanded it to all healthcare. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay. Other question is, I'm aware in certain cultures when someone is ill, it's considered unkind, particularly if it's terminal, to give them all information. This has been a complicated part of the discussion on informed consent of maybe we shouldn't tell everybody everything because it'll just scare them and overwhelm them. In an international decision, how was that discussed? because I run into that argument a lot here too.
Yeah, so that's interesting. So, you know, in general medical care, that issue of like, we don't want to give patients bad news, like that went out the window decades ago. Like actually, I come from a very hyper medical family. Both my parents are physicians and they both work in cancer medicine. And it's like the idea that you don't tell people what they're up against, that's been gone for 30 years. In this country, not in other countries, I totally agree with you, but in this country, that's been gone. What's interesting is the 86 Act really totally undermined informed consent around vaccines. So, and it's really interesting, Bernadette and Jack and I worked around this. When the law was first passed, there were actually 12-page informed consent statements that parents had to sign, and they actually really detailed the risks of vaccines, and guess what? Parents were like, hell no, I'm not doing this to my kid. And what did the American Academy of Pediatrics do? They put in place an amendment to the 86 Act to change it to the 2-page nonsense pieces of paper that are now sometimes given to patients or to vaccinees. And they're usually not given because there's no penalty to doctors if they don't give it. We don't have truly an informed consent doctrine around vaccination. We in theory we do under state law, but in practice under vaccines, The only thing that the manufacturer has to do is to give the information to the doctor. The doctor is what's called a learned intermediary. So the doctor is supposed to be telling you what the risks are. And as we know, most doctors are going to tell you, oh, well, the benefits grossly outweigh the risks, right?
I wonder if you get your vaccination at the pharmacy, no doctor around, you can disvote.
Well, you can ask for, I mean, this is crazy. And now we're talking about, you know, 9-year-olds giving quote unquote consent to vaccines. I mean, this is just channel stuffing is what Michael Belkin calls it, right? This is all marketing. This is like, okay, we're selling them through pharmacies, let's sell more through pharmacies. But you can always ask for a product insert in the pharmacy, and they still do have to preserve data. If they give you a federally recommended vaccine in a pharmacy, they still are required by law to keep information about that vaccine.
I am born in Iceland and raised in Denmark, and over there, like, when your kids go to school, it's just between you and your doctor if you don't want to vaccinate, and nobody else has to know. And so here I am, now I live in the States, my husband is American, and my kid's going to start school in the fall, and I'm being bombarded with, like, you have to pick a religious or a philosophical exemption, and, you know, they have the gene mutation on top of it, and nobody wants to recognize that. And so I'm just like, how is it really allowed? Like, I feel like I'm wearing the scarlet letter, or I feel like I'm a Jew with a star. Like, the school is going to know that she's not vaccinated, and who is to tell that they're not, like, we live in a small town, who is to tell that they're not going to tell the whole city? Like, I feel like, how is it okay in the States that you have to have an exemption to not vaccinate?
It's not okay. It's not okay. That's why we're doing what we're doing. It's not okay, but you're right. Some people, another lawyer that Alan and I work with, Greg Glazer, in these circumstances in California, has been writing letters to the schools and saying this is a violation of HIPAA. So this is, you know, medical privacy. So there are ways to push back against the school and to push back against the doctors, but it's terrible. The reality is, yes, I mean, you have to declare an exemption. I think that's totally at odds with international human rights norms, and it's totally at odds with prior, free, and informed consent.
Can I add something to that real quick? So, you know, for Washington State, there's these three things that you have to initial, and I'm basically seeing that if another kid gets a disease that they can die from, they can technically trace it back to my child and blame it on me for not vaccinating my kid. And I'm just like, how can I sign this? Like, that's just not reading into it.
Right.
Can you
run
through that? I mean, yeah. Is that the vaccine refusal form you're talking about?
Yeah.
Oh, the exemption form. Yeah. There are variations, as I think, around the country and other states, that it's actually a violation of free speech for them to require you to sign something that you disagree with. Now, whether or not you want to fight that and how you fight is a separate question. There was some parents, a group of parents. There was a mother of three who was a first or second year law student, I think, and she figured this out from her constitutional law class, and they got an attorney, they went to the health department, and they got the health department to rewrite the form. It was a very small change, because there's a difference between, it's a subtle but profound effect, a difference between saying you agree with us and saying you understand what we believe. So it was really minor wording to make that change, but all the difference in the world. I mean, I wouldn't want to sign something that said I was a terrible person.
And you may find, I mean, so, you know, you have to make these, you know, you have your peer group here, and you have to consult with people who know about what's going down in Washington State. But, you know, you might cross it out and say, I will not sign this. You know, I am applying for a whatever it is, exemption that I'm applying for. I will not sign this. Let them take legal action against you. You then have the opportunity to counterpunch. They very well may not want to go further because it looks horrible. And they know that there would be a lot of publicity, and you have a lot of friends here. So don't underplay our strength of standing on basic human rights and medical norms. You know, this is privacy. You're talking about medical privacy. They're so, you know, consider it.
You have a question over here.
I'd like to add something to that too. Feel empowered, because there are a lot of, don't feel like the Scarlet Letter, because the average person, sometimes they question what they're doing, but they don't have any knowledge to back it up. So like, I've got three kids, they're all in school. You know, I the form when my daughter started school, though I have three exceptions. I don't think I have three now, but you know, whenever my kid goes on a field trip, I have to sign the form. If there's a medical emergency, you allow all medical, if the medical care you're not able to get a hold of, you have to allow the medical doctor to do whatever they want that thinks is best for your child. I put stars, X's stars, under no condition will my child be vaccinated. Under no condition will my child be vaccinated. I sign it. And the people at the school, they just care that you're signing something.
Right, right, right.
The teacher's argument with you about
right.
I'm coming back.
You know, when my kid goes to the hospital, they get stitches, and the nurses, they don't really care about your personal life. They just want to know that they're legally covered. Oh. So, you know, my kids get stitches, and the nurses, there, and my kids know, when they saw the back movie, they know.
Okay. All right.
That's the best, yeah.
Let's get, we're going to have to.
You know what I mean.
I'm really excited to hear all more about it during the wine and cheese party afterwards. Let's get to some more questions if we can.
I have a question about the international agreement between the 193 countries plus the U.S. that you talked about. There's actual footage circulating on YouTube of Bill Gates talking about how he is knowingly using vaccines for population control in underdeveloped countries. He's admitted to saying, we're aware that this causes fertility problems, but we think that helps with population control and whatever it is that he said. And so how can, as people, this not be an international crime? How can these vaccine companies not be charged with international crime when they're knowingly distributing them to underdeveloped countries when it's a bad batch and we don't want to use it on U.S. people, but we'll send it? How is it legal? I don't understand from the legal perspective how there isn't a massive civil rights action against this.
I tried to explain, so a couple things. It's a declaration, it's not a treaty. I wish it were a treaty. So the bioethics is a declaration, so it's not legally binding. But it's definitely something that we can be using. We can say, this is not controversial. I have a right to prior free and informed consent. You cannot coerce me to vaccinate my child to go to school. That's a deprivation of my right to prior free and informed consent. So that's one thing. Is it a crime against humanity to be shipping off vaccines with aluminum and thimerosal? You know, we may be ahead of our time. It may be, in retrospect, found to be that. Certainly, World Mercury Project and Safe Minds have been working on this for many years, that it's completely unethical, potentially criminal, to be shipping to developing countries those products that we no longer consider to be safe enough for our own children. Your point about, is this a crime, the Gates point. I've watched that clip many times. Be very careful how you parse that. I don't think that's what he said. I think we have to be very careful. I think it's absolutely correct to ask these questions. Is this some, you know, what is the purpose of this? Given the scale of what we perceive to be the harms, how is this justifiable? I think those questions are very important. Is this some kind of, you know, uncontrolled experiment? Is there a eugenics component to this? I think those are legitimate. Is there a depopulation question here? Those are legitimate questions. But I would be very, very cautious to overstate what has been on the record so far on that issue.
Just a real quick thought. My understanding is that what he is really supposedly saying there, and that most of in our community are interpreting in the way that I believe you're interpreting it, the idea is that if all of your children live instead of whatever percentage, a quarter, a third, a half of them dying because of third world conditions, when the vaccines are going to have these children live, then you won't have to have as many children. You won't have to keep having children. This doesn't make sense to me now. I'm not saying I agree with it. I'm telling you this is one way this has been explained, but is what he meant. He wasn't saying let's use vaccines to kill people. He's actually supposedly saying, now, he may be doing that, okay? But I think what he intends to say or wants us to believe is that, no, what we're going to do is save children's lives, and then somehow that's going to miraculously stop third world parents from, you know, having as many children, and there'll be a delay. It'll take 10 years or so, but somewhere down the road, we'll actually see then the population, because of a drop in growth rate, the population then would decline. Doesn't make sense to me, but.
I know everybody's got tons of questions. Mary and Alan are being very generous. We still have 10 more minutes or more to get questions. Please be patient. Let me work the room so that we can all hear. Our next question is over here, and then I'm gonna go to the other side of the room. I see you all, don't worry.
Hi, I just went through the whole school exemption last week with a nurse. And when I went in there asking for a religious exemption, she asked me if I had a doctor. And I said yes, and she goes, oh no, you need a personal exemption, which I don't want to do because I feel that's going to be the first exemption taken away from us. So I said, no, I want to do a religious exemption. And she said that since I see a nurse, or since I have a doctor, although it's a naturopath, I have to go personal route with that. I don't know if you know anything by that. Okay, so I do have the exemption, and to get a religious exemption without a doctor's signature, I have to sign off that if something were to happen to my child, I reject all medical treatment.
Okay, so Drella is kind of an expert on this, if she could jump in.
No, I'm not an expert, but I've been through what the exemptions are. In Washington State, we have two types of religious exemptions. Okay. One, a doctor does not need to sign because you belong to some kind of religion that does not accept any medical care at all. I don't know what religions...
It's Christian Science. I looked it
up. Right. So that would be like possibly the only one. The other side of the form, groups, medical...
And I saw
another religious kind and personal belief, philosophical, together, the doctor has to sign all of them.
Okay,
so and you can fill out the religious part of that and have your doctor sign it. It's not probably constitutional, but that's our law here right now.
Okay, thank you. Yeah. I'm trying to make this quick. One other question. Do the schools receive benefits if they get a certain amount of a percentage of their students vaccinated? And where can I find this information if it's true?
Levy laws? Levy laws would determine, they think, a certain percentage of vaccination. And they'll give you
She's answering it by explaining that possibly levy laws can mandate certain percentages. We're a little unclear on this. I don't think.
Yeah, I don't know. So on a federal level, about 60% of all vaccines are paid for by the federal government. Most children are eligible for the Vaccines for Children program. And so certainly I know New York best. In New York, definitely the schools get money in relation to the percentage of children who are vaccinated, and a principal can be fined personally and the school for exemption rates. And so New York, completely unconstitutional. There are letters we found on the internet that say that if your exemption rate is below 2% for whatever reason for a principal, you will be personally fined. And we've talked to principals who've told us that they're genuinely concerned. There's no question that's unconstitutional, and it violate state law, but that's administratively happening. So are there financial deals going on around vaccination? Definitely. Doctors also have financial incentives to vaccinate more children in their practices. If they hit certain numbers, they get incentive payments from the pharmaceutical companies. But those, it's very hard to track that. I have not really gone to the nth degree on that. Alan, do you want to?
Yeah, just another comment. There's a lot of misunderstanding by people on the other side, and some of it even is intentional, where people overstep legal lines. You know, the question a few minutes ago was about somebody who didn't understand the procedure, and they're, for whatever reason, a lot of people make assumptions. Oh, you can't have a religious exemption unless you're a Christian Scientist or something like that. They're not looking at the procedure or the law in their state. They're just sort of making that assumption from wherever they got that idea from. The starting place is, what is the law, where are the boundaries? Sometimes it's clear, sometimes it's not, but you get clear about where it's clear or where it's not clear. What does the law say? And then there's something totally different from that, which is, what do people in the real world do? And this is part of the reason we have a judicial system, because we have recourse. We can file a lawsuit if we can't work something out outside of court or whatever. But in the real world, how many of us have the money to file a lawsuit, you know, to challenge an unconstitutional law? We've got a law in my state of North Carolina that lets a child of any age consent to vaccines and other medical treatment. The first two words of the law are the words, any minor. So your two-year-old in daycare, if they can say yes, they can get a vaccine. I've never heard of that happening, but I mean, blatantly unconstitutional. We have a right, constitutional right, to parent our children, which includes medical decision-making, and I don't think any court would argue that point about a law that lets, you know, a 1.5 or 2-year-old that can say the word yes actually consent to a vaccine or other medical treatment. But these laws get on the books. And so this is part of the problem here. You know, I keep emphasizing over and over again, we've got to be legislatively active, and primarily, I think, at the state level, both levels, state and federal, but I think the primary battleground is in the state level, and I was just thrilled to see so many people out in the rain Thursday at the Capitol. You guys have a great thing going here, so keep that momentum going. That's where we got to keep not only defending against the aggressive pharmaceutical bills, but pushing our own informed choice agenda, because this is not stagnant. It's going to go one way or the other. Either they're going to push it their direction and we're going to see our rights, you know, disappear faster and faster and more, or we're going to say the buck stops here. In fact, it goes back the other way. So that's the game, the challenge we have.
Okay, up front, sir.
As an attorney, I read Brucewitz, and I come down to the question of
disclosure.
I read the Brucewitz case, and I come down to the question of disclosure. So the manufacturers of the vaccines are immune from liability, and the doctors, if for a negligent manufacturer, a negligent design, provided that they disclose fully.
Right.
So then we have these little tiny print disclosures in the package inserts, which don't get to the patients. And I think there is something in the law that says disclosure to the doctor equals disclosure to the patient, but a lot of these vaccines are not being administered by the doctors. And my question is there adequate disclosure under due process? And because there's federal action here. And also, I've written a summary of the law as thus far as I see it. If anybody wants it, come up to me afterwards and I'll give you a copy.
I think you've focused on a really important question. As I've tried to explain, because of this state police power to impose mandates, and because of the protections of the 86 Act, and then the additional protections of Brucewitz versus Wyeth, it's really hard to find lawsuits to bring in civil court. It's possible any case from the Vaccine Injury Compensation Program, in theory, can go to civil court, but it's hard. Going up against pharma is expensive. Nobody pays your legal bills in a regular civil court. I want to say that there's some good, from my perspective, From my perspective, well-considered lawsuits in this area are welcome. And one that I consider to be very interesting, going to your point, is a recent case that's been filed against Merck on behalf of a woman who was vaccine injured by the human papillomavirus vaccine. And it's a case that's being brought in California State Court. So this woman was injured in multiple ways. She lost in the Vaccine Injury Compensation Program. And this is now a case that's being brought for negligence and for failure to warn even the doctors, right? So the HPV vaccine product insert has no contraindications. And yet the clinical trials showed not only negative efficacy, but risk of between 10 and 40% for women who were infected with HPV virus of that particular, of those types, or had cleared infections of those types. So there's a case to be made, even if you can't bring a design defect claim, there's a case to be made that they did not make adequate disclosures. And I'm hoping that we can get other HPV injured women and men to bring lawsuits outside of the vaccine injury compensation program so that we can get discovery, right? One of the beauties of American civil courts is that we can ask for documents, we can put people under oath and ask them questions, we can get documents. And we need to get documents. In my best judgment, the HPV vaccine is extremely problematic, and that we did not get full disclosure to the public, much less than all the other vaccines before it. The injury rate is much higher, as reported in VAERS, and the injuries that are being brought in the VICP are much higher. I'm particularly interested to talk to people who've experienced HPV vaccine injury in their families. I'm working on that now, so please come see me afterwards. But there are a few other lawsuits that I think are really interesting. Another one is Kraling versus Merck. This is a case that's being brought in federal court in Pennsylvania. This is by two scientists who alleged that they were being forced to manipulate the data on the MMR vaccine and on the mumps component specifically. And as Dr. Lyons-Weiler pointed out, they alleged that they were being asked to put rabbit blood antibodies into the tests that were being used to demonstrate that the mumps component was effective. I've talked to some parents here today that the mumps, there are mumps outbreaks right here now in Washington. There are other lawsuits. It's hard. Another case that's very interesting is a case that came out of the omnibus autism proceeding, Hazelhurst versus Jackson Clinic, which is in state court in Tennessee. That's a case that basically says, again, the doctors didn't have adequate information. The CDC was withholding necessary information from the doctors to be able to make informed decisions about how to treat this child. So I am cautiously optimistic that we may see some new revelations in some lawsuits in the near future. I don't know if Alan shares any optimism on that. I think legislative action is probably the most important, and we do have this executive at the head of the country who is, you know, wind at our backs. He believes there's a problem. But I think lawsuits can be important too.
Yeah, I just really want to reiterate the way you said that, a well-considered lawsuit, because I have clients hiring me now to go up against recent lawsuits that lost and are now working against us, so you have to be really careful, but well chosen. And we have, there's a case up on appeal now in Florida and in state courts concerning a Catholic school that refused to allow the religious exemption. I got to do the oral argument on that one. It's first oral argument I've ever done, so that was really cool. The decision is pending. We don't have the outcome yet, but the family is tens of thousands of dollars in debt to the trial court attorneys they still owe money to, and to co-counsel with me in the case. So if anybody has interest in the case or knows anywhere, you know, would like to help them in any amount at all whatsoever, they have a GoFundMe page.
Can we have a round of applause for Marion Allen, please?